Hi and welcome back. Well, if you've been watching this channel for any time at all, you've seen some drone footage pop up on the videos. And I purchased a DJI Mini. It's kind of an entry-level one, but it's kind of cool because it's only 249 grams. And as part of that, I thought I would go ahead and get my Part 107 commercial drone pilot license. Technically, if you're earning any money from using your drone, then you're supposed to have the 107 license. And since the channel on YouTube is monetized, I thought it prudent to get that. So I thought what I'd do is walk through the steps that I took to pass the test. I passed it with a 90. I was sure when I finished the test, I thought, I haven't passed this thing. I'm going to have to take it all over again. But came away with a 90, so I thought I'd share some of the concepts that I use to pass, in case you're thinking about doing it too. So first, when you start, there's some registration processes that you have to go through. It's all you're going to have to register on the FAA site, and then they'll assign you a testing location and so on and so forth. But I was just going to tell you a little bit more about the steps that I took. So like everybody else, when I first started studying, first of all, let me back up. I thought that what I would do was I had a window of a couple of months, and I thought, you know, I'm not going to put any pressure on myself. I'm just going to study along until I feel like I'm okay, and then I'll take the test. But after a while, I started thinking, you know, I'm not putting as much effort into this as I should. So I made a reservation, and in 2 weeks, I'm taking the test. Anyway, I made a reservation for 2 weeks. In 2 weeks, I would take the test. So like everybody else, I started on the internet, went to YouTube, and everybody, I think, goes to Tony Northrup's site. And I started watching that. And it was mostly fact-based. Tony does a lot of tech reviews and camera reviews. He's a professional photographer. And after you watch it, it's obvious that he's also a pilot. But he said this was the easiest test he'd ever taken. He said, I've got about 45 certifications, and this is the easiest one. So I started kind of on that down that path thinking, well, it can't be this difficult. But so I started watching that, and he had a lot of facts and figures. 3 statute miles, 400 feet, and I'm really good at remembering facts and figures, so I thought, well, this would be a piece of cake. So I kept doing that, and then I would hop around and look at other people's sites and try and understand what was going on, but I didn't feel like I was really getting the hang-up of what was going on, in particular, the airspace. So I went out to the local airfield, and I bought a Miami sectional chart. 1, 2, 3, looks like there's about 24 of these around the country, and Miami also includes West Palm Beach. Now, the fact that it was Miami is irrelevant. It was just that I couldn't really see on the computer screen the detail that I wanted to. So this is what a sectional chart looks like. It costs $12. And if you don't know where to get it, let me tell you. Of course, you can get everything online, but let me see if I can find a little piece here to show you. Okay, here's the guts of the thing. and this is, I mean, you're trying to look at this crazy, all this class B, C, D, E, G. You're trying to look at this on a computer screen and you just can't do it. So I went and bought one of these. Now, where I would recommend that you would get one if you didn't get one online, if you're in a town that has a commercial airport, they'll also have what's called an FBO, or fixed base operation. And that's the small, non-commercial side of the airport. And they will have these for sale. Like I say, I paid $12 for it. I didn't use it very much at all, but just once or twice, I opened it up on the dining room table, turned on the lights, got my magnifying glass, and went over it. I'm shade color blind. And so it's very hard for me to see some of these colored circles. I don't know if you're going to be able to see this or not. But anyway, there's, you know, lots of colored rings and overlapping, and I thought, man, I am just going to be absolutely sunk on this. So I got that, and then I guess I should, before I recorded this, I should have straightened this out a little bit better. But what I did was I went to, Tony Northrup, he has a test questions that you can download, or statistics or something. So I did that, And then I downloaded, this is FAA Remote Pilot Small Unmanned Aircraft Systems Study Guide. And this thing is 80 pages. So I just printed this whole thing off and printed Tony's stuff. And then I started watching other videos online as well. After I got into it a little bit, I realized I don't really know as much as I think I do. Although people that take tests a lot say, you always, if you study, you always know more than you think you do. Anyway, this is what you really need right here. Remote FAA Remote Pilot Small Unmanned Aircraft Systems. This goes into really, really great detail. Now, the other thing that I did was, there are a couple, I looked at different people online, three or four of them. Anyway, I paid $50 for the practice quiz, and I was supposed to get 600 questions, but you know, you get tangled up in technology and it never worked out. So I got a bunch of questions, but I just kept going over and over and over again. This one guy, I wish I could think of his name. If I do before I publish this, I'll put a link down below. He was really, really informative. But like I said, I listened to about six guys and one woman all the time. And the biggest problem that I had was when you get into it, you're going to have to learn about these meteorological reports, the TAFs and the METARs. And it's all cryptic, alphanumeric, well, you could say gibberish, but it's alphanumeric message of what the forecast is going to be. It's either a forecast right now, or it's a snapshot of what, excuse me, or it's a snapshot of what the forecast is going to be. One is right now, and the other one is in the future. But it's a little cryptic alphanumeric series that you've got to learn to read, and it took me a very long time to get a handle on that. There was a piece that I just couldn't understand. It's the piece of the TAF. TAF's a forecast. I think it's the piece that says from to. And in other words, it's a time period. It's not open-ended, beginning at and extending. It's from this to this. Well, if the TAF forecast happens to cover 2 days, then you have to go back and figure when that time bracket fits into the forecast parameters. And I couldn't get a handle on that for the longest time. So maybe you don't have any trouble with that at all, but it's just really difficult. I went into it thinking that it was going to be really fact-based. And since I understand facts really, really well, or can remember them, names, dates, places, addresses, phone numbers, and things are very easy for me to remember, I thought this would be a piece of cake. When I got to the test, it was a really great, easy testing facility. They make sure you've got everything you need, and there's actually a sectional little test book with some of this stuff in it. But what happened was, it was not fact-based. I was expecting a question like, just as an example, what's the maximum altitude you can fly a drone? What, you know, the answer is 400 feet. 400 feet above the ground level. And I thought that would be the type of thing that I was going to be in my test. But the one I got was not like that at all. It was very conceptual based. And it really, really threw me for a loop. When I walked out of there, I said, geez, I don't think I passed this thing. Other thing, they'll give you a little calculator. I brought a small calculator with me, and I brought a big magnifying glass. When you start looking at these sectional charts, there's a lot of details in there. And some of these class B and C and D airspaces all overlap and cut in and out. And I mean, you have to be down there with a fine tooth comb. And also obstacles. They'll show up on the sectional chart as little mountains. And they'll have the heights on them. The two heights are above ground level and above mean sea level. There's always, every time I try and come outside and record, there's something going on. There's guys down here now with leaf blowers. Anyway, I brought a small calculator and I brought a magnifying glass with me because there's little stuff on this sectional chart that's hard to read, and these class B, C, and D, and E airspaces all overlap each other and cut in and cut out. I mean, you would think, logically, you would think that the most controlled airspace is right around the airport, then less controlled, then less controlled, but it doesn't work that way at all. I mean, they go around and they cut back in, and some of the airports, little private airports, are in little cutouts, and the obstacles, whether they're towers or mountains or whatever, very small, the numbers are hard to read, and it's real easy. Some of the stuff is very easy to read, but some of the stuff you really need a magnifying glass with. So, in summary, what I would tell you is, first of all, go on the internet, go on YouTube, because anything you want to learn is on YouTube. Now, let me just point out one other thing to you. All of the guys that are selling classes have these very high success rates. And so that, coupled with Tony Northrup saying it was the easiest test he ever took, I thought, well, this would be pretty easy to get through. But I wouldn't underestimate the test. I don't think it's really, really necessary. It's only 60 questions, and you only have to get a 70 on it, so you can miss 18 questions. But I wouldn't underestimate it. But I would try and study a little bit for the different concepts, not so much the facts and figures. So, in summary, what I would tell you is go start with Tony Northrup's, like everybody else's. Video's got like 1.5 million views or something. Then look around, look at the other people. Again, I'll see if I can find the people that I signed up with and put it down below. I'm not recommending their classes. I'm just telling you that the ones I use, and I found that they really met my learning style really well. You're going to want to print this. For the third time, the FAA Remote Pilot Small Unmanned Aircraft System Study Guide, 80 pages. You're going to probably want, get a sectional map. You know, they tell you, I don't know if you can see any of this detail, this is 4K, but I'm not sure if it's in focus or not. They tell you that this legend, they give it to you when you take the test, but if you look at this stuff, I mean, this is really small stuff, so it's nice to have this around the house before you, while you're studying for the test. You just take your magnifying glass and you go over, well, here's a class E, here's a class G, here's what all the different airports look like. On your sectional chart, they're very small, so it's really kind of nice to look at them and say, oh, okay, well, this one's got runways, da-da-da-da-da. And then this piece right here is really critical. You also want to study about these automated weather systems and connections to the ground and things like that. This piece right here is really helpful. For $12, this was a good deal. I just wish I'd got more use out of it. And then the final thing that I did, I brought this to show you. These are my handwritten notes. And you know, people that know how to take tests properly tell you that you learn things when you hear them, see them, repeat them, and write them. So I just got a bunch of paper, and I just went through, as I went through that study guide page by page, I wrote everything that I thought was important. That one doesn't have much on it, but and here it is. Then the reason some of it's yellow is I went, you know, see, this is interesting. This is the first page I opened it to. This has got Tony's stuff on it. 16 years, 55 pounds, 13 years, 30 days, 10 days, 500. That's where I thought this thing was going. So I took all these are pages and pages of handwritten notes. Then when I got right to the end, I went back through and I highlighted all of the, what I thought were the really key or salient points that I needed to remember. And then I also went through, I'm out here in a park and it's kind of windy. I also, this is the FAA guide. I did the same thing here. I went through and I made notes, I highlighted stuff. Now, 80 pages, you're not going to remember all this stuff, but, you know, some of this stuff, I thought, you know, would really help out and make it easy to study. So I condensed this into handwritten notes, and then I highlighted in yellow the stuff that I really thought we needed to learn. So that's it. If you go take your 107, best of luck to you. If you have questions or you want to leave a comment down below, this is what I think. Tell me what you think. And also, if you pass the test or don't, leave us a comment down below. I know there's some people that are out there studying and want to do it. And in the meantime, I'm learning to fly my drone a little bit better so I can up the quality of the videos that I present to you. And I really appreciate you watching. If you've enjoyed this one, I'm going to do another video on learning to fly this for beginners. There's a guy, his name is Sean. He's got a site called Air Photography, and he does drones, tech, and cameras. And he's really great. He's very easy to listen to. He's got a really nice setup. It just shows straight down on his hands, and he knows an awful lot about all this stuff. But I thought, you know, there's also, he lives in Canada, so he's, you know, indoors all the time, and I'm in South Florida. So I thought I'd, you know, come out and tell you some things, and I continue to watch YouTube videos all the time. Yesterday I was watching, and they said one of the things you really should do is take your battery out. So I'll be trying to pass stuff like that along. And I have a friend who's a professional drone pilot. He's got several really big expensive drones, including a thermographic engine imaging one. He also did some of the footage of the collapse of the Seaside Towers down in Miami Beach. They wanted some analysis of the water intrusion there, so he did that for them as well. Anyway, if you've enjoyed this and think you learned anything, I really appreciate it. Leave a comment down below. Tell me what else you'd like me to check out here in the Jupiter area. And if you have time to give me a thumbs up, I really appreciate it. And so, till the next one, I'll see you on the next video.